and with power. With the Holy Ghost and with power. He said, bring your vessel, not a few, as the Lord commanded you. Bring your vessels, not a few, as the Lord commanded you. He will fill your heart today with the Holy Ghost and with power. With the Holy Ghost and with power. Lord, I need a filling of the Holy Ghost. I need a filling of the Holy Ghost. Here am I with my vessels, not a few. Fill them, O Lord. Fill my vessels. Fill my vessels. Fill my vessels with the Holy Ghost and with power. In Jesus' name. Father, Lord, we thank you. We worship you. We praise you for the just concluded retreat. How you have taught us during the retreat about salvation and the fruits of the Spirit, and about sanctification for saved believers. And Lord, here we are talking about baptism of the Holy Ghost for sanctified believer. And we have sung that it will fill my heart today to overflowing. As the Lord commanded me, bring my vessel and not a few. It will fill my heart today to overflowing with the Holy Ghost and with power. Lord, I pray that every vessel present here tonight and every vessel that are going to listen to it later through the internet and the CD or DVD, Lord God, I pray that you fill the heart of everyone with the Holy Ghost and with power in Jesus' name. Amen. Lord, that everyone will be so filled by thy Spirit. That the way the drunkard are being moved by alcohol, they will be moved by the Spirit in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Speak and teach thy people. Because everyone are eagerly waiting to learn of you and to be filled with the Holy Ghost and with power. Speak through me, O Lord, for thy people are ready to receive the Holy Ghost and power. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
We know that in the concluded retreat, we were taught about salvation and the fruits of the Spirit. We were also taught in that salvation of the fruit and the fruit of the Spirit about the false road to salvation and the true road to salvation. And we see the step to salvation. And we learned again about sanctification for saved believers. That sanctification is not for unsaved believers. That there are saved believers and there are unsaved believers. And one of the champions of the unsaved believers, and we show it unto us, that is the devil. That in the book of James chapter 2, the Bible says, the devil believeth, that believeth that there is one God, you doeth good. The devil believeth also, but tremble. So we say all the unsaved believers, their kind of belief is like that of the devil. He believes in the law, but he doesn't obey the law. He believes that God exists, but he doesn't obey the God. Yet he wants to overthrow God. He envies the position of God. And so are the unsaved believers. They never submit to the direction of God or the authority of God, but they believe there is God. But saved believers are different. Unsaved believers are still in the category of churchgoers, but they never knew the Lord. They are churchgoers, but they never knew what? The Lord. But why saved believers? They know the Lord, and they still go to church. You understand? So there is a great difference between them. And now we are talking about sanctification for saved believers. Remember, saved believers, they have repented from their sins. They are not the one Jesus was telling when the people told him about those people in Galilee that Pilate mingled their blood with their with his sacrifice. And Jesus told those ones, unsaved believers, think that ye are better than them, except ye do what? Repent, ye shall likewise perish. But saved believers, Jesus is not asking them to repent again because they have repented. They have confessed their sin and forsaken them. They have accepted Jesus as their Lord and Savior. And they are now following Jesus day after day. They are now doing what? Following Jesus day after day. They have the yoke of Jesus upon them. That is, they allow Jesus to control their life, to be the master of their life. And that is why Jesus is showing saved believers more things that saved believers can get: sanctification. And when they got sanctified, he said there is still more things. You don't stop in salvation. You don't stop in sanctification. There are more things to still receive. Baptism of the Holy Ghost. And we sang, it will fill my heart today to overflowing, as the Lord commanded me. Bring your vessel, not a few. It will fill my heart today. It will fill your heart today with the Holy Ghost and with power. Not just with the Holy Ghost, not just with speaking in tongues, but and with what? Power. And we are going to see in this teaching of today that the Lord has for us. The text is taken from the book of Joel. Joel chapter 2, verse 12 to 29. Joel chapter 2, verses 12 to 29. It says, therefore also now, saith the Lord, turn ye even to me with all your heart. Turn ye even to me with what? All your heart. And with fasting, and with weeping, and with mourning. And rend your heart, and not your garments. You know, in those days, when one say repent, that, oh, look at what I did. I'm not happy what I did against God. He will tear his garment. At times, the heart did not repent. If we do the outward show, people will say, see how he feel bad. He tear his clothes that he has committed sin. But the heart may not be repented. You understand? But people only see the outward one, but it's only God that sees what? The inside one. That's why God said, and rend your heart, tear your heart, and not your garment. Men don't see the inside. I see the inside. I see that you just make a spiritual show by tearing the garment, and they look at you, oh, so spiritual. He has repented. He tears his clothes. Are we getting it? God said, tear your heart. Let me see it in your heart. That you feel bad in your heart. That you repent in your heart, and not your garment. And turn unto the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and of great kindness. And repented him of the evil. Who knoweth if he will return and repent and leave a blessing behind him, even a meat offering and a drink offering unto the Lord your God. Blow the trumpets in Zion. Sanctify a fast. Call a solemn assembly. Gather the people together. The congregation. Gather the people, sanctify the congregation. Let everybody be sanctified because they want to receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost. They want to receive a greater thing from the Lord. Sanctify the congregation. Assemble the elders. Gather the children. Baptism of the Holy Ghost is for children also. Gather what? The children. Let the bridegroom go forth out, go forth of his chamber, and the bride out of her closet. Even people that just got married, they still need to receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost if they get sanctified. We got it. He said, let the priest, the minister of the Lord, weep. The minister of the Lord need also to do what? Weep and pray unto the Lord between the pot and the altar. And let them say, spare thy people, O Lord, and give not thy heritage to reproach, that the heathen should rule over them. Wherefore should they say, among the heathen, where is their God? Don't let people start saying, where is your God? After you get saved, move on to sanctification. After you get sanctified, move on to be baptized with the Holy Ghost. Are we getting it? And receive all the blessing God has for you. Don't let people be saying, where is their God? Don't let people be saying, what? Where is their God? Look at 18. Then, if you've done your part, you are saved, you are sanctified, and you now fast and you are now praying, asking God, you can couple it with fasting, asking God to bless you with this blessing of baptism of the Holy Ghost. Then will the Lord be jealous for his land and pity his people. The Lord will now do what? Pity his people. 19 now. Yea, the Lord will answer and say unto his people, behold, I will send you corn. Amen. I will send you corn and wine and oil, and ye shall be satisfied therewith. And I will no more make you a reproach among the heathen. But I will remove far off from you the northern army. Who are this army? Anything that devour your money. You understand? Let's look at what this army are. The northern army. And will drive him into a land barren and desolate, with his face toward the east sea, and his inner part toward the uttermost sea, and his stink shall come up, and his heel sabot shall come up, because he hath done great things. Fear not, O land, be glad and rejoice, for the Lord will do great things. Amen.
Amen.
Be not afraid, ye beast of the field, for the pastures of the wilderness do spring, for the tree beareth her fruit, the fig tree and the vine do yield their strength. Be glad then, ye children of Zion, and rejoice in the Lord, your God, for he hath given you the former rain. Amen.
Amen.
Moderately, not the rain that will flush everything away, you understand? Moderately, and he will cause to come down for you the rain, the former rain, and the latter rain, in the first month, and the floors shall be full of wheat. Amen.
Amen.
And the vast shall overflow with wine and oil, and I will restore to you the years that the locust hath eaten. You see, who are those army there? Locust. He eats their crops. Eats their, so those are the armies. Anything that is eating your finance, eating your prosperity, you understand? Eating good thing that is yours. They are those northern army. God said he will send them away. The canker one, and the caterpillar, and the palmer one, my great army, which I sent among you. That's when one was not doing right. God allowed them to come. You understand? When one repented, he gets saved, sanctified, he's going for a higher step, God drove them all away. Say, don't come close to this person. It's mine. You understand? Now look at 26. And ye shall eat in plenty. Amen.
Amen.
And be satisfied, and praise the name of the Lord your God, that hath dealt wondrously with you, and my people shall never be ashamed. Amen.
Amen.
And ye shall know that I am in the midst of Israel, and that I am the Lord your God, and none else. And none else, and my people shall never be ashamed. Amen. And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. And your sons and daughters, are we hearing children also? We understand. And your sons and daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions. And also upon the servants and upon the handmaid, in those days will I pour out my spirit. So the Lord says, for everybody. Nobody is exempted. Children will be baptized in the Holy Ghost. Adults will be baptized in the Holy Ghost. Even like Jeremiah, right from the womb, he was already filled. You understand? The Lord will bless us in Jesus' name. Now, we are going to look at it rapidly in 3 points. The first point is the promise of the Holy Ghost. baptism. The promise of the Holy Ghost baptism. The second point is the purpose of the Holy Ghost baptism. The purpose of the Holy Ghost baptism. And the last point is going to be how to get the Holy Ghost baptism experience. How to get this experience? How to get baptized in the Holy Ghost? Let's look at the first point. The purpose, the promise of the Holy Ghost baptism. Joel chapter 2 verse 28 and 29. He said, and it shall come to pass. Stop there first. You know, if you open the Bible, just open few verses or few pages, you will come across that word again. It has come to pass. You open some again, you see, and it came to pass. You open some again, it come to pass. Which means, listen to me, any problem didn't come to stay forever. Amen.
Amen.
Are we getting it? It came to do what? To pass. Are we getting it? It came to do what? To pass. It didn't come to stay. So when you see any problem, you say, pass on, you didn't come to stay. Continue your journey. You came to pass. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
God is good.
Hallelujah.
So he says, and it came to pass afterward. Because that problem has been there. The problem of famine. Cancan woman and all this thing that we're eating, all those northern army, causing all those havoc on the land. It finally came to pass. And they went away. And so will all problems in your life pass away in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Then he said, and it come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. And your sons and daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions. And also upon the servants and upon the handmaids, in those days will I pour out my spirit. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
God said, that's the promise of the Father for you. The prophet Joel and other servants of God, God promised to pour his spirit upon sanctified Israelites and by extension on every sanctified believer today that taste for him. That taste for who? For him. That taste for the Holy Ghost. You know, one thing with God is God doesn't force anybody. He doesn't do what? Force anybody. But he expects everybody to desire, to want it, to desire it. Then he will give to the person. It's like somebody is not thirsty for water. You give him a cup of water. What will he do with the water? He will play with the water and spill it away. But if the person is really thirsty, and he himself comes to you and says, give me a cup of water, please. A cup of water. The moment you give the person a cup of water, what will happen? He will drink everything and say, can you give me one more cup? You got it? Because he was really thirsty. So God doesn't force his Holy Ghost upon people. And he expects one to be willing, desiring, before he will give to the person. And the person must ask. And you see, like we see in Isaiah 44 verse 3, God has also promised through Isaiah the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Isaiah 44 verse 3, it says here, for I will pour water upon him that is thirsty, not upon him that is not thirsty. God knows I need the Holy Ghost. He's supposed to pour it upon me. I don't need to be thirsty for it before he will pour it upon me or ask him. He said, no, for I will pour water upon him that is thirsty and floods upon the dry ground. I will pour my spirit upon this thy seed and my blessing upon thy offspring. We understand. but they have to be tasty. Are we getting it? Yes. But the one that is not tasty, no need. You understand? Because he won't know the value. It is he that is tasty, she that is tasty, that the Lord will pour it upon. And Zechariah chapter 12. Zechariah chapter 12, verse 10 to 14. Zechariah chapter 12, verse 10 to 14. It says here, and I will pour upon the house of David and upon the inhabitants of Jerusalem the spirit of grace and of supplication, and they shall look upon me, whom they have pierced, and they shall mourn for him as one mourneth for his only son, and shall be in bitterness for him, as one that is in bitterness for his firstborn. In that day shall there be a great mourning. That is, everybody will be given to prayer. You understand? A great mourning in Jerusalem, as the mourning of Adarim Rimon in the valley of Megiddon, and the land shall mourn, every family apart. That is, every family will be prayerful when everybody is filled with the Holy Ghost. Are we getting it? Every family apart, the family of David apart, and their wives apart, the family of the house of Nathan apart, and their wives apart. That is, women are praying, men are doing what?
Praying.
The family of the house of Levi apart, and their wives apart. The family of Shimei apart, and their wives apart. All the families that remain, every family apart, and their wives apart. Everybody will be prayerful. Because the spirit of prayer and supplication, baptism of the Holy Ghost, is come upon them. And the Lord has promised it, and he will give unto us in Jesus' name. Amen. And in Luke chapter 24. Luke chapter 24. Luke chapter 24. Verse 49. It says here, and behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until ye be endued with power from on high. The power is coming from above. Baptism of the Holy Ghost. You see, I send the promise of my Father. My Father promised it through Prophet Joel, through Prophet Isaiah. He said, I send, also through Prophet Zechariah, he said, now I send the promise of my Father upon you. Tarry ye in Jerusalem. Continue praying in Jerusalem. Tarry in prayer in Jerusalem until you receive the endowment of power from on high. You will receive it today in Jesus' name.
Amen.
And in Acts chapter 2, in Acts chapter 2, Acts chapter 2, verse, let's first read chapter 1, please. Acts chapter 1, verse 8. It says, but ye shall receive power. Ye shall receive what?
Power.
After that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem, and in all Judea, and in Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth. Ye shall receive power. Ye shall receive power. And when you receive that power, you'll be preaching about, witnesses to Jesus, wanting souls to repent of their sin and turn to Jesus. You shall receive the power. And you receive it today in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Acts chapter 2, verse 38. Acts chapter 2, verse 38. 38 and 39. Then Peter said unto them, repent. He said what? Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins. He said, after you've repented, you need to desire to obey baptism in water according to how Jesus Christ ordered us. But if there is no time yet, but you are ready to do it, you still receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost, then you now do it later. We got it. Because it happened like that in the book of Acts chapter 10, which I'll show us later. So he said, then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sin, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. It is a gift. So you don't need to pay any money for it. Are we getting it? It is what? A gift. But to get this gift, you have to desire it. You'll be born again, sanctify, then desire it and ask God. And God will do what? Baptize you, give you the gift. Then 39 says, for the promise is unto you. We got it? The promise is unto you. Tell yourself, this promise is unto me. It's for me. Not only that, and to your children. Are you getting it, children? It's for you also. And to all that are afar off. And even as many as the Lord our God shall call. All those that are still going to surrender their life to Christ. The promise is also for them. Are we getting it? Praise the Lord. So, the Lord is telling us this promise is for us all. I told us there are people that receive it before baptism in water because there was no time. You understand? They have to first receive it, then later they were baptized in water. Let's go to the book of Acts chapter 10. Acts chapter 10. From verse 44. Are we there? I'm reading from 44 to 48. But as I read on, I may pause. When Peter yet spake this words, the Holy Ghost fell on all them which had the word. And they of the circumcision which believed were astonished, as many as came with Peter, because that on the Gentiles also was poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost. For they had them speak with tongues, and magnify God. Then answer Peter, can any man forbid water? These people are already baptized with the Holy Ghost. Can they forbid water? Not to enter into water and be baptized as Jesus commanded? He said, can anyone forbid water that these should not be baptized, which have received the Holy Ghost as well as we? They have received the same thing we've received. What is stopping us from taking them to water and baptize them now? You understand? And verse 48. And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of the Lord. Then prayed they in to tarry certain days. So they now baptized them in water. Praise the Lord. You will be baptized by the Holy Ghost tonight. And later, baptism in water will follow. If you have not done it according to how Jesus said, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
But you receive the power now and start utilizing the power. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Or do you want to wait for, say, after I have finished that one, I'll come and receive power. You will get the power tonight in Jesus' name.
Amen.
That takes us to the second point. What is the purpose of baptism of the Holy Ghost? Why do we need to be baptized with the baptism of the Holy Ghost? The purpose of the Holy Ghost baptism. Acts chapter 1 verse 8. Acts chapter 1 verse 8. Acts chapter 1 verse 8. He said, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be my witnesses. That's the purpose. The purpose is to be witness unto the Lord. The purpose is for you to be able to preach, reach out to souls, bring them out of darkness to the marvelous life of our Lord through the preaching. Are we getting it? He said, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria, and unto all the uttermost part of the earth. That reminds me of someone some years back. We have in prayer meeting, it's always read in prayer meeting and everything. But now when we now talk about baptism of the Holy Ghost, it was really serious to get baptism of the Holy Ghost. He prayed. Days he spent time praying to get it. He didn't get it. Then he approached me. I said, "Why is it? I've been praying for baptism of the Holy Ghost and the Lord is not baptizing me." I said, "Do you know, you want to know why?" He said, "Yes." I say, every time when we come to prayer meeting, when we say, "Let's pray for this brother that on this area, pray on behalf of this brother," you don't pray for that brother. You pray, "God bless my business. God bless my business. God bless my business. Okay, let's pray for the salvation of souls. God bless my business. God," all the prayer he knows is what? "Bless my business." He doesn't care about others. And the purpose of the baptism of the Holy Ghost is not, "God bless my business." It is for what? For the salvation of souls. To witness to others. Are we getting it? So I said, God knows that you will not use it for what he wants you to use it for. It's, "God bless my business," you use it for. That's why you are not receiving the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Change your kind of way of thinking only about yourself. Not praying for another person. Only praying for yourself. Yourself. Let's somebody put it like this. Me, my, I. How many people is that? One. You understand? So, I said, that is the reason. So you want the baptism of the Holy Ghost. You have to be thinking of others, praying for others also. God, we know you are not selfish. You understand? Then, God can baptize you with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Because it's not meant to use for yourself alone. It's to be able to reach out. To be able to do what?
Reach out.
And you do that in Jesus' name.
Amen.
So the purpose of the Holy Ghost baptism is for us to witness for the Lord. Everywhere. Because we see here, he said, "Witness unto me both in Jerusalem," that is the immediate place where you are, "and in all Judea, a little bit far from you, and in Samaria, far from you, and unto the uttermost part of the world," everywhere in the world, to witness for the Lord. Now, you can witness, we know, through telephone, through email, through letters, and all means. So let's look at these purposes, one after the other. A, to receive power to witness for Christ. We just read it in Acts chapter 1, verse 8. So we don't need to read that again. B, to bring to our remembrance all Jesus ever taught us. In the book of John, chapter 14, verse 26. John 14:26. It says here, "But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things." He shall do what? Teach you all things. And bring all things to your remembrance. Whatsoever I have said unto you. Stop there. You know when you look at the Bible, you say, "Look at the volume. It's so big. How can I remember everything?" You understand? But when you are baptized in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Ghost will be bringing to your remembrance. Are we getting it? All things that the Lord has told you through his word. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So that's the purpose of the Holy Ghost. C, He also said he will teach us all things, but I'll teach you us again. See, to guide us into all truth, so that you will not be deceived. That's why we are surprised. Those that say they are baptized in the Holy Ghost, and they are preachers, and they are teaching wrong things. Is that Holy Ghost that made them to teach all wrong things? No, it means they are not baptized in the Holy Ghost. That they are only deceiving themselves. Are we getting it? See it in John chapter 16, verse 14. He said, "He shall glorify me, for he shall receive of mine and shall show it unto you." Sorry, I was reading a different one. Verse 13. "Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth." He will guide you into all truth. He will not guide you into error. Are we getting it? Into all truth. So when someone is preaching error, it means he's not baptizing the Holy Ghost. Because the Holy Ghost will not guide you into error. Are we getting it? He will guide you into all truth. "For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak." Wait there. Even Holy Ghost is not going to speak of himself. He will speak what Jesus spoke. So then, why will human being now want to prove that he is to know? You understand? Instead of speaking what Jesus spoke, now he's speaking a different thing. Are we getting it? So he said, he will not speak of himself. "Whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come." Things to come. Why we said our children will get monthly program, so that we will not be like Europe churches are today. The older people generation did not teach the generation that follows them. Now, nobody to take their place. Even before they all vanish, nobody. Church building are being sold to businessmen now. So, you know, the Holy Spirit shows us things to come. Now, let's see more. See, to glorify Jesus in us. That's verse 14. "He shall glorify me." Jesus said he will do what? Glorify him. "For he shall receive of mine and shall show it unto me." Let's wait a little bit. He's not going to be glorifying the founder of the church. He will glorify who? Jesus. You understand? He will glorify who? Jesus. But the error of many is, instead of lifting up Jesus, they lift up the founder of that church. You hardly hear them mention Jesus. He's just the founder of that church, the founder of that church, the founder of that church. He's now their Jesus. Are we getting it? It shouldn't be so. The Holy Ghost will glorify who? Jesus. The Lord will help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
He to comfort us. That's chapter 14 now of John, verse 26. He said, "But when the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name," the Comforter is to comfort us. Is to do what? Comfort us. You know, Paul the Apostle, when he prays on prayer, he said, "God have comfort us, to comfort you with his comfort in the Holy Ghost." You know, it's the Holy Ghost that knows how to comfort you. Let's say something happened. Somebody lost a member of his family or something like that. All the things people try to use to comfort cannot comfort like the Holy Ghost. Are we getting it? The Holy Ghost that is the one that knows the best way to comfort this person. We understand. Even comfort some we try to comfort may not even be comfort to that person. Are we getting it? But the Holy Ghost knows how to comfort. Some may think when they come and cry, it will comfort the person. But actually, most of the time, it doesn't comfort the person. Somebody that now needs to be encouraged, they are making to cry again. Then the person will cry until all the tears in his body is almost gone. The voice crack. Then strength, maybe there are children or other to take care of, then no strength to take care of those ones. Are we getting it? Because instead of comforting, they cause more harm without knowing. But the Holy Ghost, the comforter, he knows how to comfort. Let's see one way the Holy Ghost comforts those that are bereaved. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13. But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others, which have no hope. You understand? He said, I don't want you to be sorrowing like those that have no hope. Are we getting the point? You see how the Holy Ghost comforts? When you sorrow, you are not able to do other things. You are thinking about your all other way are blocked because of the sorrow. He said, I don't want you to be like those that don't have hope. You have hope. Look at 14. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also we slept asleep in Jesus will God bring with him. Those who sleep with Jesus, God will do what? Bring with him. You see the comfort? So now, if one don't know, it's just like someone. He lost someone. Before he lost the person was there, but the person, you won't know that there is somebody so close to him that he's at the point of going. You understand? Because he's praising God and everything and things like that. Even after the whole ordeal, he's still perfectly okay. Because he just makes sure that the person is ready. He makes sure that the person is what?
Ready.
That it's not going to hell, it's going to where? Heaven. So when the person is going to heaven, was he supposed to be crying that the person is going to heaven? No. It's when the person is going to hell, he should be crying, isn't it? So he was settled, and the Lord will help us in Jesus' name. So the purpose of the Holy Ghost is to comfort us. Who comforts that person? It's the Holy Ghost. It's to comfort us. To teach us all things. The same John chapter 14 verse 26. He said, but the comforter which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things. He shall teach you all things. Because Jesus told the disciples, he said, there are many things I want to teach you, but you cannot stand it now. It's too heavy for you. But when the Holy Ghost is come, when the Comforter is coming, he will teach you all things. Are we getting it?
Yes.
The Lord will help us in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, the baptism of the Holy Ghost and power is very necessary. You need it. You do what? You need it. Because with it, Jesus will be doing wonders in your life and through your life in Jesus' name. Acts chapter 10 verse 38, he talked about how Jesus did great things. Look at it there. In Acts chapter 10 verse 38, he says, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. He said Jesus did everything through what? The Holy Ghost and power. So, you need it also. If Jesus was baptized in the Holy Ghost, you need also, as a follower of Jesus, to be baptized in the Holy Ghost. And we go to the last point, how to get baptized in the Holy Ghost. The steps to the Holy Ghost baptism are, first, you must be born again. It is first, you must be what? Born again. In other words, you must have been saved by grace. Because Jesus says in Matthew chapter 7, verse 6, don't give our holy things to the swine. Look at it, Matthew chapter 7, verse 6. Matthew 7, verse 6. Give not that which is holy unto the dogs, neither cast ye your pearls before swine, lest they trample them under their feet, and turn again and rend you. He said, don't give it to them. He said, because they don't know the value. When you give something that is holy to the dog will spoil the something and come back and get angry with you. What did you give me? You understand? Are we getting it? So God said he cannot give the Holy Ghost to them. To the dogs. Who are the dogs? Those that behave like dog. Dog. They, you see how they commit immorality outside? He said, those are the dogs, unbeliever. Are we getting it?
Yes.
Swine. Dirty. Immoral. All those kind of life we are hearing, the homosexual and this, all these things, that is what pigs does. You understand? And they are dirty. Where did they put pig? Dirty place. Pig don't want any neat place. Sin is dirty. He says, so you can't give the Holy Ghost to a dirty soul until the soul have repented and sanctified for the Holy Ghost to come in. What is the name? Holy Ghost. It is not dirty ghost. It is not sinful ghost. Holy Ghost. So it must enter a holy place. Are we getting it? And we read during our retreat in Deuteronomy that God said, is to walk among us, and he doesn't want to see what? Unclean thing. Then I make us to read verses, preceding verses, so that we know what he was talking about. He said, when the children of Israel want to toilet, they have an instrument there, and they go far away from there. They dig the ground, and when the thing come out from there, they have to now cover it up. Because he wants everything to be what? Neat. Are we getting it?
Yes.
So the same way, God is saying he will not give Holy Ghost to any unclean. So, one must have been born again. You must have been what? Born again. Saved from sin. You must have also been sanctified by the Lord. You will have asked Christ, sanctify me, make me holy as you are holy. If not, you may start using the power for wrong purpose. If the person is not sanctified, he will be using the power for what? Wrong purpose. Just like the person I made mention, that only knows about what? His business. You understand? A child of God, you know how to pray and everything, but you only care about yourself. Is that not selfishness? And God will not give the Holy Ghost baptism to such, because he will use it wrongly. Look at Jeremiah 17 verse 9. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? That is why there is a need for sanctification. It's Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 9, I just read. That is why there is a need for sanctification before God can give the person the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And apart from that, after being sanctified also, you need to taste hunger to be sanctified, to be baptized with the Holy Ghost. Let's look at it. The steps I've just mentioned, taste and hunger for baptism of the Holy Ghost. In John chapter 7, verse 37. John 7, 37. It says here, in the last day, The great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, if any man thirst, if any man do what? Thirst. Let him come to me and drink. So the person must be thirsty. He must be thirsty. Then, and when he's thirsty, he comes to Christ. Christ will give to him or her to drink. Thirsty and hunger. Two, come unto who?
God.
Jesus, which is also God. Come to Jesus through prayer. Go to him through prayer and drink. In Luke chapter 9, chapter 11, verse 9 to 13, Jesus here makes us to know that if you ask him bread, he will not give you stone. You understand? He's a good God. Let's look at it. Luke chapter 11, verse 9 to 11. He says, and I say unto you, ask and it shall be given you. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asketh, receiveth. Do you understand? If you ask, God say what? You will receive. And he that seeketh, findeth. And to him that knocketh, it shall be opened. If a son shall ask bread of any of you that is a father, will he give him a stone? Fathers, will he give him a stone? Your son say, father, daddy, I need bread. He say, you need bread? Take, eat this stone. No father will do that. Are we getting it? And he said, or if he asks a fish, will he for a fish give him a serpent? No. So when you are asking for Holy Ghost, God will not give you evil spirits. Are we getting it?
Yes.
Because one will be afraid, say, I don't know whether it's evil spirit that will come. Is God you are asking to give you Holy Ghost? God will not give you evil spirits. You are a child of God. God will give you what he has for you. It's the devil that wants evil. Evil, you understand? Now, look at it, 12. Or, if he shall ask an egg, will he offer him a scorpion? No. If ye then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to them that ask him? He said, God knows how to give good things better than we. You understand? He says, what you ask him, he will give it to you. Then, see, drink. Says what? Drink. After God has given it to you, what will you do? You drink it. If he give you the Holy Ghost, you drink it or receive the Holy Ghost by believing. Let's look at the book of John again, 7:37. We read before. We now read 38 along with it. Or we read only 37. But it said here, in the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. That is, after water has been given to you, you ask for a cup of water. And the person gave you a cup of water, a glass of water. And you say, I say, I'm thirsty, I needed water. I say, but I've given you the glass of water, drink. He said, help me drink it. How will I help you? It's in your hand, you drink it, put it in your mouth and drink. Then swallow it yourself. Are we getting it? So you've asked. Let's say you've asked, then God has answered. You now have to receive it with the hand of faith. In the book of Mark chapter 11 verse 24. Mark 11:24. Therefore I say unto you, what things soever ye desire when ye pray, believe. Do what? Believe that ye receive them. Not believe that I will receive them one day. That is, you are pushing it further. You are pushing it what? Further, one day. Maybe tomorrow I will receive it. Maybe tomorrow. Maybe next tomorrow. One day I will receive it. No. Believe that you have received it already. Believe that you have done? Receive it already. That's faith. Because Hebrews chapter 11 verse 6 say, now, for without faith, it is impossible to please God. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. You must believe. So, therefore, I say unto you, what whatsoever ye desire when ye pray, believe that ye receive them, and ye shall have them. If you believe you have received them, then you have them. If you believe that one day I will receive them, then you'll be waiting for that one day. Are we getting it? Believe that you have received them, and ye shall have them. Ye shall have them tonight in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Finally, speak as the Spirit gives you utterance. And now let me explain. When you believe, you start praising God, thanking Him for giving you baptizing you with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And as you are thanking Him, as you are praising Him, as you are appreciating Him, then the Holy Ghost will give you utterance, which is the D. Speak as the Spirit gives you utterance or move you to speak. You now start saying what the Spirit said. Just leave your tongue free. Just be praising the Lord. All of a sudden, you find your tongue speaking another language. You don't even understand what He's saying. But God knows what you are saying. You understand? So, don't let the devil come and deceive you immediately and say, you are the one that formed that one. Just continue. You understand? And the Lord will bless us in Jesus' name. Let's read chapter 2, verse 4. Acts chapter 2, verse 4. Acts chapter 2, verse 4. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. They began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. They didn't say, Spirit, no. Why are you speaking Japanese language? Is this thing a Hindu language I wanted you to speak? Oh, no. You shouldn't have speak that language. That's not the one I like to speak. No. You are not the one that we decided. It's as the Spirit gave you what? Utterance. Are we getting it? You may even not know the language you are speaking, that whether it's Chinese or Hindu or anyone, but you speak as the Holy Ghost gives you utterances. And the Lord will bless you as you do that in Jesus' name. We round it up with 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 21. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 21. For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved. You understand? The same way as God moved these people to write and moved those prophets to write His word for us, the Holy Ghost will give you utterance, move you to speak, to pray in an unknown language. Let's stand upon our feet and talk to the Lord now. Remember, are you saved? If you are saved, you ask God to sanctify you. If you are sanctified, you ask God to baptize you with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. You have to desire for it. Desire to be baptized in the Holy Ghost. Desire to be baptized in the Holy Ghost. Ask the Lord for it and believe. And start praising the Lord. And the Spirit of the Lord will move you to speak. Will move you to announce His presence in you. Talk to the Lord. Talk to the Lord. Pray. Pray and believe the Lord. Pray and believe the Lord. Talk to the Lord, talk to the Lord, talk to the Lord. Talk to the Lord. Ask Him to baptize you with the baptism of the Holy Ghost and with power. Talk to the Lord. Talk to the Lord. Talk to the Lord. Talk to the Lord. Ask Him. He's willing to baptize you. Remember, if you ask Him a bread, He will not give you a stone. It's what you ask Him, He will give unto you. So ask Him, and He will give unto you freely, because the promise is unto you, and unto your children, and to all, and to those that are far away, and to all that the Lord, our Father, He's going to call. Talk to the Lord. Ask Him to baptize you. He's willing. He's willing. Because through the song we sang, He said He will fill your heart today to overflowing. As the Lord commanded you. Bring your vessel, not a few. He will fill your heart today to overflowing with the Holy Ghost, with fire, and with power. And now He's pouring His Spirit. Ask Him, and receive. He's pouring His Spirit now. The Holy Ghost is present. The Holy Ghost is present. Receive Him. Receive Him. Receive the Spirit. Receive the Spirit. Receive the Spirit. Receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost right now. Receive it. Receive it. Receive it right now. 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 It's present here now. It's mightily present. It's mightily present. Receive it. Receive ye the Spirit. Receive it right now. In the mighty name of Jesus. Receive it. Receive it. Receive it. Receive it. Receive the Spirit. Receive the Spirit. Receive the Spirit. Receive Him right now. Receive Him right now. Receive Him right now. He's mightily present now. Receive Him. Receive Him. Receive Him. Receive Him. Receive Him. Receive Him. Continue praying. Continue praying.
In the mighty name of Jesus.
And the Lord bless you with the blessing.